Hey everyone, I'm Jerry James Stone, and I'm super thrilled about today's video because it's not only a recipe, it's also an interview. I have this delicious spin on a classic Paloma, plus I interviewed Mike Madrid from the Lincoln Project. I'm really excited to share this with you. Let's get to it. So here's the thing. I think food is 100% political. It's the most political thing that you do every single day. Your choices about what you eat and the choices that you have about what you eat are absolutely political. If you live in a food desert or if you live next to an organic farm, how we treat our land, the water, the energy that we use, farmer rights, all of that stuff goes into what food is, and you have to eat, right? So it's the most political thing that you do every single day. So I was really super excited to sit down and talk with Mike Madrid from the Lincoln Project, because those of you that follow me on social media know I'm not a fan of Trump. And the Lincoln Project is Republicans are trying to get him out of office. There's a lot of good reasons to get him out of office. He's hurt our farmers, our small farmers are suffering from like his whole tariff war with China. It's just, there's, you know, a lot of really, really, really good reasons. And it was just fun to sit down and talk to someone who is a Republican and has been a Republican for quite a long time and worked on Republican campaigns and what his view is on why this president is bad for America. So we sat down and talked about that. Don't listen to me about it. Let's just get to the interview.
First off, thank you for joining me today. glad that we finally made this happen. I didn't realize when we reshuffled that I was that we're doing it on debate night.
That's all right. These things happen. You can't plan for all of these externalities. So I'm really glad to be here. I'm excited for it.
Yeah, me too. I've been following everything that you know, has been doing on the Lincoln Project. I guess probably to start, maybe tell me a little bit about, you know, yourself, your involvement with the Lincoln Project, and like just the Lincoln Project in general.
So the Lincoln Project is, it was actually eight of us, former and current Republican political consultants, all of us who've been involved in the very, you know, the highest levels of Republican politics throughout our careers, people who've run presidential campaigns, governor's races, Senate races, who realized that the current president, Donald Trump, and candidly the U.S. Senate and other Republican leaders who've enabled his behavior have metastasized into a threat to this country, not just a problem for the party, which it has always been and continues to be, but this is a problem for the country. And we realized that if we didn't stand up and do something about it and use the skill set that we have to campaign against them, who would? And so back in November, December timeframe of last year, the eight of us decided we would lock arms and jump ship and kind of, you know, light our careers and relationships on fire. And, you know, there's tons of people in the Republican Party who've ostracized us and attack us regularly. Yeah. But, you know, we're here because we believe that this president is a threat to the United States of America and our institutions, the norms that have run in a very successful country. And frankly, he's a threat to democracy itself. And so as a result, the Lincoln Project has been engaged over the course of the past eight months. Feels like 8 years.
Right. This year feels 84 years long. So.
Oh, just brutal. And so we've been engaged in this type of activity to, you know, unseat him and to do everything we can to make sure that he doesn't win re-election. So that's who we are and that's what we do. And I'm a California guy. I think we're probably neighbors, same area.
Probably, yeah.
I'm the only Californian in the crew, but I'm thinking I'm doing my best to represent the West Coast, and we're all over the country doing our thing. And it's been a difficult, I'm not going to say it hasn't been, personally and professionally difficult time on top of the pandemic. But it's not anything that I regret for a moment. I'm very, proud of meeting this moment as it's come and ready to do everything I can to the last minute to make sure that Trump is not reelected.
Well, and, you know, I think that food is super political. So for me, like, you know, I get people who are always kind of like, shut up and cook or, you know, whatever, like anytime you kind of dip your toe into politics, but we all have to eat. And, you know, how we grow our food, who's picking our food, access to food, like how we treat our energy, water, what pesticides we use or don't use, all those things come down to politics. And so to me, food is the most political thing that we do every day because you have no choice but to eat. And so, you know, it's interesting to kind of, you know, have this conversation because I've talked to some people where we've been on the political side of things, but you're sort of in the thick of it. And I'm kind of curious, I'm assuming that you did support Trump back in 2016. And correct me if I'm wrong, please. And like, you did not support him? No?
I've never supported him.
Never supported him.
Okay. No, I'm not one of those people that came around and figured it out. I was opposed to Donald Trump the moment he came down the escalator. I think, I hope that doesn't ruin the rest of the interview, but
No, not at all.
I've never supported him. I've been very publicly opposed from the very beginning, and I will be until we remove him from office.
Well, the reason I was kind of setting up, the question I was going to set up is like, you know, I guess, you know, talking to people who probably have supported him back in 2016, what has that transition been like? What's convincing people? Because it seems like there's some people like, no matter what, like 200,000 dead Americans from COVID, doesn't matter, you know, not paying taxes, you know, cheating on his wife, paying porn stars for sex, none of those things seem to matter, you know. So the people that have actually kind of turned the corner on him, what have you seen as sort of being the thing that makes them turn that corner?
Yeah, that's a really great question. Let me answer it this way. I'm going to answer it tactically as a political professional first, in terms of the context of the race. I don't want to spend much time on that because it's probably not what your viewers are usually used to.
It's okay.
But what I will say, to be successful in making sure he's not reelected, we only need 4% of Republicans to not vote for him. Not even to vote for Joe Biden, just to not vote for Donald Trump. 4%. So we're talking about a very marginal amount. The Republican Party has been shrinking at a very fast pace ever since Donald Trump took office. And people have been leaving on their own volition for the past few years. The question then becomes, and it's probably really a deeply psychological one, because our political identities are very important to our personal identities. In the same way that food is very important to us as human beings, the way we perceive the world and the lens through which we look at the world is really central to who we are. So there's a very strong argument that the attacks that Donald Trump comes under actually fortifies even more in the minds of his supporters that they're on the right track. And it gets so bad that at a certain point, you start to not take into account things like facts, or you stop believing the news, or you start to believe that no matter whenever he uses the buzzword fake news,
right,
that means don't believe anything that you have heard before, believe what I'm about to tell you. And there's almost a whole hypnotic cult-like feature to Trumpism. There just is. There's going to have to be a lot of work done after this about social phenomenon to explain a lot of this. So, but what we have found is that for very different personal reasons, people break off at different points. I had a lot of friends finally give up after Charlottesville. They just said, I've had enough. I'm done with that. Some people left with the, you know, paying the porn stars off. Some people left with attacking our troops. There's a big story today about his deriding evangelical voters. So it's just kind of this cascading effect where, like a lot of people who are in bad relationships, they start to make decisions in their own time frame based off of whatever their tolerance level is for what they're doing, and until they finally say, I've had enough. I'm not going to do this anymore. I won't stand by this, and I won't support it. While there's still a wide swath of people that will go down all the way to the end and don't care.
One of the things that I love that the Lincoln Project is doing that I'm very much on the liberal side of things. And, you know, I've been that way for quite a long time. I was raised by Republicans, though. I grew up in a conservative household that listened to Rush Limbaugh. So, I mean,
That explains it. That explains it.
Yeah, exactly. And so, you know, I'm on the liberal side, and I kind of just wonder too, like, what is the future of the Republican Party? Kind of, where is it going? Because you sort of see, you know, you see my generation. I'm Gen X. You know, you kind of see a split between like Republicans and Democrats. I mean, obviously there's independents too, but millennials, Gen Z, you see a huge gap in, you know, support for Democrats. And just, you know, I think a lot of that is tied to like sort of social issues, climate change, those types of things. A lot of things that, you know, the Republicans have traditionally dug in. How does the Republican Party bounce back from something like this?
That's a really good question too. I don't think it does. I think that it's dug its own grave, and the exits from the freeway, from that the crazy freeway, were about 10, 15 years in the past.
Yeah.
And Republicans chose not only to not get off the exit, but to hit the gas and get in the fast lane and speed on down, you know, down the crazy highway, right? And so now they're there. They're in the land of crazy. And the thing is, when you go this nuts, when you go this overboard, like, people remember that. Not just that, you know, people will forgive you for changing your mind on positions all day long. In fact, I think they appreciate that sometimes. They don't forgive you for what they've put this country under over the last 3 years. This is not your typical ideological debate. We're not just having a discussion about tax increases, okay? We're talking about basic foundational elements of Americanness and American identity and what's okay and what's not. We're talking about flirting with dictatorship and authoritarianism, and it's dangerous. It's not funny, it's not cute, it's not entertaining, it's not reality TV show. It's a threat to the Republic. And you don't get to just wake up one day and say, wow, that was a crazy ass bender. Like I was, you know, I drank too much last night, but I'm good. Like this is that bottoming out moment for the Republican Party where you've gone too far and people are saying, you're just not only not healthy, you're a danger, not just to yourself, you're a danger to everybody else. I think that is why there's been such a split and such an exodus from the Republican Party, and frankly, why I think there will continue to be. So that's kind of where things, I think, stand. I am not optimistic about a return of the Republican Party. I believe the Republican Party's brand is so tainted for at least a generation that it's going to really have a very difficult time of resuscitating itself. That doesn't mean that I don't think that there isn't an opportunity for conservative ideas. I just don't believe that the Republican Party will be a vehicle for that going forward.
You know, and I agree with you. I mean, I started out my career as a software developer, and I worked for about 10 years as a contractor for the Department of Defense. So, you know, I was sort of in the thick of, like, you know, being around military Republicans, you know, for a good part of my professional life. And, you know, I think that there's places where, you know, some of those conservative ideas definitely have a place. But, you know, it's these, I feel like this, like this social stuff that we're kind of digging in on, you know, the people that are, you know, supporting Black Lives Matters and the people that are, you know, calling them terrorists and, you know, those different things that are happening and how that's kind of going on. Like how does it turn the corner on those social issues? Can they even rebuild that at all?
I don't think so. I've never seen politically any candidate or organization poll so low with young voters, minority voters, Latino voters in California specifically,
right,
LGBTQ voters. What could the party offer them at this point that would change that impression? To me, I think that the brand is just, look, I've been a Republican for 30 years. I don't want to work in coalition with half of the Republicans I've known for 25 or 30 years because they've supported this nonsense. Right. It's like, this is one of those moments. It's like the Edmund Pettus Bridge during the march on Selma. It's like, what side of the bridge were you on? Like, this is that moment to decide. And if you are so dug in that you are supporting a president who supports the Confederate flag, who is more concerned with Confederate statues than he is the death of 200,000 Americans, I don't know what I have in common with you. Even if I agree with you on tax policy, I feel a little dirty for agreeing with you on it, right? So I don't know where it goes. And like I'm saying, I don't know that it should come back. And this is somebody who spent 30 years and my entire professional career working in the movement, right? So I think that it has become so tainted, so soiled in a brand that we're going to have to see something new emanate. I also don't believe that will happen anytime soon. I think the Republican Party will continue to slide down into the abyss of irrelevancy and marginalization the way it has in California. That's going to happen nationally. And in the interim, you know, there will be ideological skirmishes in the Democratic Party, and people that have so grown distasteful of the Republican Party are going to have to figure out where they want to lay their chips and figure out what they're going to do next. But I don't believe it's going to be with the Republican Party.
You've worked on Republican campaigns, correct?
Yeah, yeah.
What are some of the campaigns you've worked on in your professional career?
Well, I mean, I've worked on thousands of them, but I began my career. You know, the most high-profile one, I guess, the last major one I worked on was for Dan Lundgren in California in 1998, his governor's race. I just worked earlier this March on getting the Republican mayor of Fresno elected, Chief Dyer in Fresno. I've worked for hundreds of local mayors and council members, Republican mayors and council members, which is where my area of expertise is in California. But I worked on George W. Bush's race in 2000, presidential campaign. And I've, you know, worked for numerous pieces of different campaigns throughout boy, throughout the years, the California Republican Party itself was my client up until about 2 years ago, just doing data work for them. So yeah, it's kind of been kind of a mishmash. Most of my work now is less partisan, and it tends to be a little bit more ballot measure work.
Okay. Okay. What, and you're sort of, I mean, I guess, you know, you're kind of talking about how you don't really see the Republican Party coming back from this. And I agree with you to some degree. I mean, I've kind of been saying that for years. I think the GOP is dead on some level because these younger generations just don't buy into the social issues that they're, you know, they dig into, from, you know, pro-choice, pro-life, all that kind of stuff, to the LGBT stuff, to climate change. What to you is sort of the ideal next conservative party? I don't, you can give it a name, maybe it's called the Lincoln Party, but you know, if it's sort of the next version.
Well,
of the conservative
party. Yeah, I've never been animated by social issues at all. I think they've too often become an ugly weapon that have been politicized, when that's not really in the spirit of our Americanness in the first place.
Agree.
I am very animated by economic policy and by policies related to transparency and reform. So for example, I think we carry too much debt. I think government is, frankly, it's too big in some areas. I do also think it's too small in some areas. I think the pandemic gives us a perfect example of why we need a bigger healthcare net, right? Safety net, right? That's an example. But I do believe like things like our education system need dramatic reform, that the Democratic Party's institutions and its problems won't allow for reforming, and breaks my heart every day that especially Black and Brown kids aren't getting a good education. I think that's very fixable. But I don't believe in no government. I believe in good, conservative, transparent government. And what that means is, the same way you may run your own checkbook conservatively,
right?
That's what I mean. You need to run our government conservatively. And by that, I don't mean you need to run it like a business. Government is not a business,
right?
And shouldn't be run like that.
Yeah.
I really despise that terminology, because government is literally not private industry. There are certain things that private industry should not be engaged in, things like prisons, things like policing.
Yeah.
Things like utilities, right? Water management and electricity. Those are things that government has a rightful role in regulating and overseeing. But I do want transparency. I do want oversight. I do want accountability. California is an example of where I think we don't have any of that. I think we've got a Democratic Party that's gone too far. But, you know, more specifically to your issues, yeah, those are all issues that I don't think that should be in the political arena by and large, right?
Yeah.
I mean, they're not political per se.
Right.
The fact that you think you can make those decisions based off of a majority of people thinking you can or you can't, it just doesn't ring true to me in terms of governance. It doesn't make sense.
And that's one of the issues I mean, when I was working for the Department of Defense, one of the issues I had there was the fact that, you know, we'd be on these programs where they're like, oh, we still have, you know, 50K left on the program, but we didn't burn it all. So find a way to burn through it, you know, and year after year, project after project, it's just like, this is taxpayer money that we're just burning.
Yeah.
You know, there's not a efficient way to complete these projects. And if we do complete them under budget, to put that money back in the pool, because then you don't get it the next year. And it was just, you know, it was really disheartening for me, because I'm like, these are people, this people's money. It's not like, you know, a business that earned this money. We taxed people and took it from them, and we're just burning through it to buy new computers because we have leftover cash, you know?
Yeah. That's money that could be going to put food in the belly of hungry kids.
Right.
Or, you know, or buying more resources for schools. So, you know, look, I understand when you're running mega, you know, $1 million budgets and operations, and government is inefficient by its nature. It just is. There's you have to be under, that's just modern civilized society.
Yeah.
But we can do better. We just can.
Yeah.
And so that's just kind of my philosophy of governance is, I'm not anti-government. I'm anti-bad government.
Yeah.
And so that's probably a type of Republicanness that's maybe gone. it probably is gone. But I also don't see that a place for me in the Democratic Party either. I don't see that wing of the Democratic Party flexing its muscles and saying, you know what, this isn't right. Maybe government can do better. In fact, I see it barreling down the wrong way too. And I think the Democratic Party has its own host of problems. They're not a threat to the Republic the way the Republicans are.
Yeah. I mean, they definitely there's definitely a bucket of flaws in the Democratic Party also. And I mean, that's why I'm registered independent for that reason, because it's just, you know, I don't really, even though I'm on the liberal side, I don't feel that the Democrats fully are where I want things to be either.
Yeah.
I'm kind of curious though, are there any Republicans that you feel maybe are that represent like what you think, you know, the Republican Party should be right now? Anyone sort of in the, you know, top tickets that, you know, are like ideal?
I mean, I really like Larry Hogan, the governor of Maryland, and Charlie Baker, the governor of Massachusetts. The irony is they are the most popular governors in America, and they are Republican governors of very blue states. And the reason why is because they articulated a blend of what you and I are just talking about. They're very progressive on social issues, don't really care about, you know, interfering in people's personal lives.
Right.
But they have a very stringent code of making government work and run efficiently and run better and be more accountable. And I think that it takes, in many instances, a Republican like that, who's not, and look, it's 2020, so the fact that I have to say this is embarrassing, but someone who's not racist, it would be nice, you know?
Yeah.
Someone who's not homophobic would be nice.
Right.
Someone who's not, you know, just if the Republican Party could get past all that, and I don't know that it can, because those are becoming defining features of the party now. They're not just fringe elements.
Right.
That we used to just kind of placate and go, okay, they're part of the coalition, you know, whatever. It's like your crazy uncle at Thanksgiving dinner, right? It's like you put up with them for a while, and then after four or five Thanksgivings, you're kind of like, maybe we just shouldn't have Uncle Charlie over anymore, because he's a problem to himself and everybody else, and he needs to go take some personal inventory and deal with those issues before we let him back into the family.
Right.
I mean, that's literally what it's become. And so, you know, at that point, I'm not too sure where you go. But I do believe that you know, these are kind of obscure governors. Yeah, I'm also proud of Mitt Romney for standing up to Trump.
Yeah.
Not always, but enough when it really matters on impeachment and saying enough. John McCain was a hero of mine. You know, he's a war hero. He's an American hero, whether you agree with him or not politically. Those
right.
are people that we've looked to historically to say, okay, we may disagree on policy issues, but you have the character and you've literally bled on foreign soil and spent years in a jail cell in Hanoi because you cared enough to go and die for this country. I never did that, you know?
Right, right.
So, you know, I'm not going to judge you because of your policy positions. They may be different, but I'm never, ever going to doubt your commitment to this country and to what American greatness is.
It is,
you know, I mean, weird. it is weird. The sad part is there's, like that's, how is that not obvious? Like, how is that not the norm? But we've got a president who derides him and hates him because he got caught. And it's just, we're so fringy now. There's so much room for normalcy.
Right.
That I'm hoping we've bottomed out of the country and are finally like, you know what, let's just get back to, how about normal?
I think there's two things, there's probably more than two things, but there's two things that I think really kind of have put us in the situation that we're in now. I think and I would love to just, you can disagree or agree, I'm kind of curious
what
you think of them. One, I think, you know, you kind of talk about education in general as far as like, you know, putting more money into those educational systems. And I think some of that, you know, you've seen like in red states where those Republican state legislatures have like gutted those educational systems. And so I think part of the people that you have kind of buying into these crazy conspiracies and triggered by the fears that Trump kind of strokes with, you know, racism and bigotry and just all that kind of stuff, they maybe just aren't trained enough to get past it, you know, so they're kind of interacting on these sort of primal reactions to someone that's, you know, feeding the fears, because we have a government and an economy that doesn't work for everyone, right? We've seen like Amazon not paying any taxes with, you know, Jeff Bezos being like this trillionaire, whatever kind of guy, you know, we have that discrepancy. And so I think that some of that comes down to like education and fear and just the economy.
Yeah. And I think, look, there's a good mix of that, right? And is there some truth to what you're saying? Of course there is. Does that answer all of it? Probably not.
No,
you're not suggesting that, but you're just saying, is this one of the causes? I think it is. Sure. I do believe, though, that there are some two very unique dynamics that are changing America that we've never dealt with before. And one of them you just tapped into. That is the extraordinary division between the haves and the have-nots. The income inequality gap is becoming unsustainable.
It's and gross. It's just gross. Yeah,
it's gross. It's immoral. And what happens in an environment like that is you breed populism where people are just like, the system doesn't work. Jeff Bezos didn't pay any taxes?
Right.
Come on. The guy was making a couple hundred million a day during the pandemic or something ridiculous. It's like, that's just not right under any system that you could come up with ideologically. That is not right.
Right.
And so that's got to, that the income inequality gap and the policies that allow for that need to end. That's one. The second, and by the way, the first we have experienced before during the Gilded Age, and it was Teddy Roosevelt and reformers who came up and broke up the monopolies. At the time, the tech companies were oil companies, and he broke up the railroads. He broke up the oil companies. He broke up the transportation, you know, the shipping industries. Everybody that was a monopoly, much like Amazon is, it's got too much power in our economy.
Right.
It took a reformer, like a Republican reformer like Teddy Roosevelt, to go in and break it up. We're at that point now. The second area, though, and this is perhaps more important, and that is the demography of the country is changing at such a rapid pace now. You know, this is the first generation of Americans that are of a white European majority that are leaving in America to a non-white European majority. Yeah. And that scares a lot of people. And in that environment, the politics of the Republican Party are really more about white identity and white grievance than they are about capitalism or freedom or tax policy or whatever it used to be. Yes. When I was very active with the party. It's not, you know, whoever thought that the Republicans would be the pro-Russia party, right?
Or the yes, or the, thank right, you. Thank you right. So much for saying that.
What the hell's going on? What the hell's going on, right?
Reagan is turning over in his grave.
yeah, because it's not anything like Reagan's party.
No.
Say what you will about Ronald Reagan, he was not pro-Russia. Okay?
Definitely not.
but Donald Trump is. And we can speculate as to why, but he is. And the crazy thing, the scary thing, is not just that he's pro-Russia, it's that 85-90% of the Republican Party was just like, okay, yeah, let's go be pro-Russia. Which yeah. tells you they really never had those beliefs in the first place. They're simply motivated by this tribal identity, and increasingly that tribal identity is white identity. And it's reacting to this stimuli of a changing America, where it's like, if America's not a white Christian nation, it's not really America. So I don't mind if we tear it down anyway or burn it down, because if I can't have it, you can't have it.
Right. Well, and I agree with you. I think that white privilege part, you know, is just a tough pill for a lot of people to sort of swallow and figure out. And you kind of see that in the sort of BLM stuff, because I think Black Lives Matter is not the best maybe slogan for what that group is trying to accomplish. I understand some of the knee-jerk reaction, but the fact that people, it's not like, you know, it's kind of coming back to something that's not related to people. It's, you know, when you say save the whales, it doesn't mean like, you know, off turtles, right? It's like not like, you know, it's not like you're saying like, yes, I'm going to save the whales and everything else in the ocean can just die. It doesn't, but like, right, you know, Black Lives Matter sort of turned into that kind of, you know, sort of siren call for people. And I think that kind of comes to like my second point was, I think we're in part of this situation we're in too, and, you know, social media exacerbates this a lot, is that we've been raised to not talk politics, not talk religion, because they're difficult, you know, topics. And so I think we have a bunch of people that don't know how to talk about this stuff because we were raised to not really talk about it. And now they're trying to figure out and try to navigate those conversations, which sometimes feel personal and like you're being attacked when you're not necessarily being attacked. It's just, you know, and I think it's difficult for people to sort of, you know, reconcile those conversations with the fact that the white privilege and like sort of like their state and where they are.
I think that's right. And I think we are, you know, look, racism is the original sin of America.
Yeah.
And, you know, as a Republican, I'll be candid, it's taken me a long time to come to really, and by the way, my area of expertise is in Latino and racial politics, which makes me very peculiar, because I have an expertise in racial politics, but I also have an expertise in Republican politics, which doesn't make a whole hell of a lot of sense. I understand the irony in the comedy in that. But because I understand both worlds, what I will say is I do deeply understand how systemic racism is in America. America was founded, the economy of America was founded on slavery.
Yeah.
Our original documents have it written throughout. We lasted 150 years debating whether or not we should do this, and it was finally resolved with the bloodiest war in our nation's history. So it's not only kind of there, it is centrally there. And there are still people who cannot come to terms with accepting that, and so they deny it. And that's a lot of what Republicanism is. It's like, well, if you just work hard, you could be like everybody else.
Right.
And it's just such an overly simplistic understanding of the complexity of our American history.
Yeah.
And I don't, like I said, we are at a point now where the Republican Party is no longer a party of ideas. It's no longer a party of ideology. It's a party of commonality. And that commonality is about this threatened white identity. And it needs to glorify its past. It needs to dream of returning to its past, knowing full well that that will never happen.
Yeah.
And it needs to advocate for policies that defend and protect it, because a people in decline or who sense they're in decline can be very dangerous. Can be very dangerous. When our own identities are threatened, we often lash out. First of all, we become very self-destructive. And let me bring this back to food. You know, the one demographic in Western America that has increasing rates of obesity are white, non-college educated people in the Rust Belt. Yeah. They have high rates of obesity, high rates of poverty, high rates of opioid addiction, high rates of suicide, high rates of gun violence. There's a reason why mass shooters are overwhelmingly white men, young white men. It's not coincidence.
Yeah.
It's happening because this is a demographic that feels that it is losing something, that it is in decline, and it would rather be destructive than try to find some sort of hope because it's lost hope. And the party, the Republican Party, has become the home of that grievance politics, and Donald Trump has trafficked in it. And so, again, when we talk about an emerging America, right, America that is not a non-college educated white Christian male, it's basically everybody else is who the Democratic Party is speaking to.
Right.
That conflict is likely to become very adversarial and very, unfortunately, very violent. But it's really a very much a story about a nation in transition, a country in transition. And the only question for me is, can we hold on to our institutions while those that are in power are hell-bent on tearing it down because they sense their imminent loss? The imminent change, because it's happening whether they like it or not.
I feel like, I want to hope that answer is yes, that we can hold on to it. You just kind of reminded me of something too. I sort of feel like I want to come back to the election a little bit, because I feel one of the things that's, I really like data a lot. So I kind of look and read a lot of like just political data and numbers, and the software engineer in me, even though I don't do that anymore, still likes that stuff. And I'm really seeing a lot like in Texas that kind of looks like early 90s California. You're seeing like this huge demographic shift between like, you know, just Latino people and youth, and just kind of pushing Texas into this new ground. And I feel like Texas, I mean, I don't know if it might flip this election, but I feel like we're emerging to a point where Texas is going to be in play as a swing state, you know? And I just kind of wondering, since you're kind of in that space with, you know, those demographics too, kind of, you know, as you mentioned, what your take is on Texas.
Well, let's geek out a little bit on this, just because you opened the door a little bit. I've written a lot on Texas and California. And the reason why I've written on it is because of this one reason. If you were to look at both states' demography, they are remarkably similar. 37, 36% white, 38, 39% Latino, 13% African American, another 13% or so rounds it out with Asian Pacific Islanders. But one is ruby red and one has been really deep blue. Well, why is that? That was the real question I wanted to answer. They're so similar,
right?
Size, economies, demography, but couldn't be different more than different politically. And the answer came back, it was white voters. White voters in California are split 50-50. if you're white and you live in a county that touches the water, you're very progressive. If you're white and you're inland, you being the exception, you're very conservative, right? The conservative counties in the rural northern part of California,
right,
and in the mountains and the valleys. I call the Republican Party in California the party of the mountains, the deserts, the valleys, and, you know, the forests. It's where there are very few people, there are a lot of Republicans.
Okay? Yeah, yeah.
Not unlike the rest of the country. That's how Texas was. Up until about 8, 9, 10 years ago, suddenly you get Austin.
Right.
Austin.
I love Austin. The food there is amazing. So
there you go. Right. See, so you get technology workers going to Austin looking for quality of life.
Yeah.
They bring their politics with them. And so what happened was 10 years ago, Texas, if you were white in Texas, you were rural conservative. But over the last decade, you've got communities like Austin, Houston suburbs, Dallas, the metropolitan areas, they're kind of cool. You got really cool hip people, different thinkers, higher a number of college educated folks, technology people. There's a great food scene. There's a great music scene. There's culture. And they don't bring Republican, you know, rural cowboy politics with them.
Right.
And so the changing white electorate is actually a bigger factor than the rising Latino vote in Texas changing.
I did not know right? that. Thank
yeah. you. Yeah. But not only that, when you add both together, you end up with Texas in 2020, which is a battleground state. It's very much in play.
Yeah.
Now my guess is Trump will win it by 1 or 2 points, but not in 2024.
Yeah.
That is a blue state. The same way Arizona is moving. It's all the Sun Belt. Look at Maricopa County, Scottsdale, Mesa, Phoenix. These are cool places. These are nice places. It's a lot of Californians with high educations that don't want to pay real estate in California that are just saying, hey, I could have 4 times the house. And there's some really cool culture. There's some chefs doing some great work down there. There's some cool art museums. There's some great arenas for entertainment. It's only going to cost, I could buy a great pad for $300-400 grand. I'm there.
Right.
And that's what's happening. The whole Sun Belt is changing because the demography of white people is changing. Incidentally, and again, not to keep geeking out, but this is what I think about all day. If you look at the Rust Belt, you don't have that. No one's moving to Cleveland or Cincinnati because it's got
Cleveland, by the way.
Sorry. Well, you came here.
That's okay. We moved out here when I was 3.
Right. No one's moving to, you know, to Ohio because they love the culture and the food scene, right? It's just not a thing. Not yet. And so as a result, what do you end up with? You end up with a stagnant, declining culture. And that, of which food is a very central part of this, by the way. That's one of the main reasons people look for what kind of food is there, because I will pay a premium for good food. It's a part of the quality of life. And so when you're able to have places like that, there's actually a study with where, you know, congressional districts with Whole Foods versus Cracker Barrel, right? Democrats live in places where there's Whole Foods. Republicans live where there are Cracker Barrel restaurants.
We did just get a Cracker Barrel here.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's a conservative strain here in Sacramento too. Sacramento is the Central Valley. We forget that.
Yeah.
We try to pretend it's not. We act like we're more East Bay, but we're just as much Central Valley as East Bay. It's a clash of these two, right? Anyway, I didn't mean to take too much of a detour there, but that's what's happening in Texas, is it's changing. And the rise of the Latino vote, just like California, it's important. But what was happening in California at the same time of Prop 187, if you remember that in 1994, you also had the explosion of Silicon Valley at the same time. That was changing America or California culture, I would argue, as much or more as Hispanic culture. You add the two together, and now you get California in 2020.
Right, right. So do you think that Texas will remain red this election?
I think there's a chance that Biden wins it. I think if they were spending money there, they would. Just tactically, that does not make sense because they've got a guarantee and lockdown 270 before they get there. So I think there's probably a 30% chance that Joe Biden wins Texas, but I believe it's far greater in 2024.
What do you think as far as just election outcome in general? Do you think Trump is toast, or do you think he still has a pretty good chance of pulling it around?
He has a good chance, but the way we answer that is by saying I'd rather be Joe Biden than Donald Trump at this point. Okay. I mean, having said that, I would rather have been Hillary Clinton than Donald Trump at this point, too, a month out of the election as well. Look, I think Joe Biden's in a stronger position than Hillary Clinton. I do.
Yeah.
I believe he's probably, you know, the odds are, you look at all the data, which is what I do all day, it says Joe Biden's in a very good, strong position to win. Having said that, it is very possible that Donald Trump could win re-election.
Well, in that case, we're all going to need a drink. So let's talk about that for a bit.
Yes.
I think we talked about tequila over email. Was that our spirit of choice?
Tequila's my spirit. I do like a mezcal, which I know this is going to be heretical, but I don't like a really smoky mezcal. I know that sounds strange, but I love agave spirit.
Well, I think you just like mezcal and you don't like the sort of fad mezcal that everyone's sort of jumping on right now.
I think that's exactly right. I mean, I've spent time down in Puerto Vallarta quite a bit, and they've got a raicilla, it's called, which is a local agave spirit. I like tequila primarily. But I like agave spirits generally.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. I like, I really love reposado a lot. That's sort of a favorite of mine. And añejo is also another good one. I like those sort of oaked and spicier ones.
Yeah.
Because when I don't drink tequila, I drink bourbon. So that's kind of why.
Okay. All right.
So I'm going to come up with a tequila inspired drink for this interview. Sort of savory or sweet, like vegetable, produce, fruit, whatever.
I like something a little bit more refreshing, a little bit more fruits. I don't want to say necessarily sweet, but I guess that's probably not true. I like a little pineapple, a little, even orange juice or something, you know. I like something lively. Tequila is a lively spirit for me, right? That's the you drink that, you're dancing on the bar at the end of the night, right? That's what I love about tequila.
It's fighting.
Not so much bourbon necessarily, right? Which I love. I love a good glass of bourbon too. But that's the one spirit where you kind of get in a little bit of trouble. Which maybe that's the political consultant in me. I just like that. Like if I'm gonna drink, I'm gonna drink. I'm gonna get a little trouble.
Okay.
And that's kind of where tequila goes. So.
That sounds good. I can definitely work with that.
Work with that.
Yes, I think I can make something work with that. Well, my plan is I'll probably start working on the recipe, and then I'll probably try to. My cat is over here trying to get my attention. She's like, "You've been ignoring me."
What's your cat's name?
Her name is Ninx. Let me just grab her here. See if she'll let me grab her. Maybe. Yep. She will. She wants to hold on to everything. So she is out exploring, and she's like, "What's going on? What are you doing?" I don't typically sit at the dining room table and just hang out, so she's confused.
Okay.
So yeah, I'll come up with a drink with that, and then I'll send some ideas over to you before I finalize it. But
love that.
Try to release this video. Definitely before the election.
Okay.
So I want to get that out there. But thank you so much for taking time to.
No, thank you for having me. It's an honor. I appreciate you reaching out, and I'm like I said, I'm a local. We're neighbors. So when all of this ends and we can go out again. We'll have to share the cocktail that you make and just kind of connect.
Yes, 100%. We can get together and have that cocktail. And then the second time we can go to one of the tequila tasting at one of the bars here.
Yes.
And, you know,
once love that.
COVID nightmare is over.
I would love that.
We get someone in the presidency that will actually take action.
I'm working on it, man. I'm working on it every day.
I'm with you. Well, thank you again. Thank you for the work with the Lincoln Project. I really like what you guys are doing. I think I wish that the Democrats had a little bit more teeth with them when it came to going after their opponents. And so I like what the Lincoln Project is doing in terms of that stuff. You guys do not hold your punches at all, and it's great.
No.
All the videos, they're great. They're just wonderful, you know, and just the tweets in general are pretty wonderful. So thank you for all that work. And hopefully we will be celebrating mid-November at the
election
with some cocktails.
It was a real pleasure to meet you. I'm looking forward to meeting you in person. And until then, just everybody keep working until the last minute. Let's make sure we make some good positive change in this country, and be a nice sigh of relief when we can have those cocktails again and not worry about the future of the Republic and just get back to fighting over tax policy.
Yes, yes. In fact, coming to that point, what's the one thing you think everyone should do to sort of help secure that we actually do get Biden into the White House this election?
You know, look, I'm going to say some things that political consultants don't normally say, but it's a pandemic year. If you can contribute, contribute. You don't have to contribute to us. You can if you'd like, but if not, pick a Senate seat. We've talked a lot about Trump, and I've never said this before in my life, my career, but we need to have a Democratic Senate, because if Trump does win, we need to have that protection of both houses to guarantee that we're safe as a country. There's five or six great seats that you can look at. So if you got $5, throw them $5. If you got $3, throw them $3. Other than that, this is a little bit unorthodox, but if you could just share our content with what we're saying, kind of the way that you do, it matters. people are in home, they're at their home and they're on social media more and they're following it. And the more these things get amplified, I you know, if anybody thinks that social media doesn't matter, then explain the Lincoln Project. We are a product of our people. I mean, literally, our people are, we really consider them partners in what we're doing. It was just 8 people in November of last year. We're not even a year old. Now there's, you know, millions and millions of followers on all of our media platforms, and we're continually driving content every day. And we've had a huge impact in this race, not because we had money. Our average contribution is like $50 or something like that. So we're not backed by any gazillionaire. We're not backed by a Republican gazillionaire. We've gotten some big contributions, don't get me wrong. But this is all a function of people tapping into people just being pissed and saying, you know what, these guys are fighting. If they're going to take a shot at the bully, we're going to back those guys. And our commitment was, we'll fight this guy every damn day, and we'll make sure that he's on defensive every damn day. And I think we've done a good job of that. But just sharing content really does matter across your platforms. It tells people we're out there. It gives us the energy to keep fighting. And we're happy and honored to do it.
Awesome. Well, I'm going to go tweet out some Lincoln Project videos and start figuring out, start drinking some tequila, for instance.
Start drinking some tequila. I like it. I like it. It's a pleasure to meet you, friend.
Yeah, nice to meet you too. Talk to you soon.
We'll do it again. Okay, bye-bye now.
Bye.
So how cool was that, right? Like, I don't know. Like I said, I think food is 100% political. I love what the Lincoln Project is doing. You know, I'm very progressive and liberal in my views, so I really want to keep moving the country forward, and I hope that they succeed in removing him from office. Biden was not my first choice for president for, you know, 2020, but it's better than Trump. So let's get to making this recipe. Okay, so we're going to make a delicious, fun twist on a Paloma. So a Paloma is typically a grapefruit and tequila type cocktail, but we're gonna just turn it up a little bit. Mike says he likes refreshing cocktails, so we're gonna take this and we're gonna use clementines instead. So to make this cocktail, the first thing you wanna do is we're gonna take some fresh marjoram and like add that to our glass. We're gonna add a little bit of sugar, and then we're gonna add a little bit of fresh lime juice. We're gonna muddle that. So when you're muddling these ingredients, you don't wanna overwork them, you just wanna get enough to like release the oils from those fresh herbs into the sugar and lime juice. So just go ahead and muddle those ingredients together, add in some ice cubes, and now we're gonna add in our tequila and then freshly squeezed clementine juice. And that's all it really takes. Just go ahead, take a lime wedge, top it off that on that cocktail, add a sprig of that marjoram there, and you're good to go. You have a delicious clementine and marjoram Paloma, super tasty. That's probably something you're gonna need to drink on November 3rd, because it's probably gonna be a while before we get the election results. I just wanna say thank you again to Mike Madrid for sitting down with me and talking to me about politics and food and everything else. I hope you enjoy this cocktail as much as I did. If you like to cook like I do, I release new videos every single week. If you have something that you wanna see, hey, just drop a comment down below. And you know what? If you like this video, give me a thumbs up. I'll see you guys next time.